It was the year 1980, and only 8 miles from Anfield Road, a newborn was welcomed into his home. This baby would be special in many ways, but for the first few months of his life, one stood out the most. He had been born with a birth defect called clubfoot, which led his feet to be twisted at his ankles, pointing inwards rather than outwards. The parents were quick to act, and after months of treatment in which the baby's feet were put into a cast that slowly forced them into their natural position, the baby ended up being able to learn how to walk at a normal pace and reduce drastically the effects it would have in his future. What no one could have guessed back then is that this baby's feet were magical, and one day they would strike some of the most euphoric long shots the world had seen. That this baby's name would be roared out by thousands for decades to come. Welcome to the life of Steven Gerrard. Growing up, he would be really shy and quiet. Only at the age of 5 did he seem to break out of his shell a bit. And of course, as we have heard so many times, the thing that did it for him was football. He joined his school squad and began excelling from pretty early on. But looking back at the pictures now, something looks off. You can easily find one of young Gerrard in an Everton kit. For a second, I was in awe. Could it be that at a certain point in his life, Steven Gerrard had been on the other side of the Merseyside derby? Well, no. Apparently, he opted for supporting Liverpool from a young age, despite having family members who supported Everton, and was forced into taking that picture after winning some kind of competition. But it is still funny to imagine, at least. There was something funny, though quite worrying, about young Gerrard. You won't believe how unlucky he was, even though it might sound weird given his incredible talent. There was one week where he was reduced to tears after being rejected from a local football academy, and only a few days later he missed a school trip to Wembley after cutting his leg in a Coke bottle as he attempted a slide tackle. That's already quite unlucky, but on another occasion, it was much, much worse. But before that, let me set the stage. Gerrard kept on improving, and it was unbelievable to those who watched, so much so that one of his teammates' parents started recording Gerrard during the games instead of his own kid. Which is kind of sad, but I'm also glad he did it in a way. That man's name was Melvin Snyder, and when asked about how it was watching a young Gerrard, he said, "He had long legs like a gazelle, he was very fast and he hated to lose. He was streets ahead of the other kids, you just couldn't believe it. He was winning Man of the Match awards on every match, despite being an 8-year-old playing with the under-10s. He was still shy though. One day we all went on a trip and he refused to come, saying he'd rather stay home. That was the last we saw of him. By the time we were back, Liverpool had gotten their hands on him." And here's when things turned sour again. Gerrard was playing in his backyard, probably just a few days before his first ever training session at Liverpool's academy. And then, the ball got stuck on some bushes, and trying to get it back, Gerrard decided to try and kick it. What he wasn't aware of is that a garden fork was in the bushes as well, and it perforated his foot, going straight into his big toe. His family rushed him to the hospital, and the first prognosis was as scary as they got. The doctors wanted to amputate his big toe. His parents immediately realized the consequences this would have on their kid's future, and once again reacted quickly, calling the Liverpool director and getting him on the phone with the hospital, trying to convince them to at least try another course of action. He spent a while in intensive care, but soon, somehow, he had actually recovered. I guess you could say he was actually kind of lucky if you're a glass half full kind of person. Gerrard spent the next 9 years in the Liverpool Academy, though there is one thing about his time that I never would have guessed. He actually never signed a long-term contract with them as a teen, and he never even got called up to the national team's youth sides. To pressure Liverpool into giving him a contract, he tried out for West Ham, even Everton, and most impressively in my opinion, at one point he even played a match for the Manchester United Academy, and Wes Brown was even on the same team. So, make of that what you will. When he turned 17, they finally gave in and got him the damn contract. The following year, he made his debut for the first team. Hulier sent him in with 3 minutes to go as a show of good faith, and Gerrard remembers that as he warmed up, he approached the stands, expecting an applause like that of every other player, but instead, the fans, perhaps after noticing how scared and nervous he was, began chanting, "Who is this skinny little boy?" Except, of course, they didn't say boy. They said another word, but I can't mention that here. He played 13 games over that first season, mostly only getting less than 10 minutes per match. Then, in 1999-2000, he started getting some more regular playing time, but very quickly he began noticing that the demands of professional football were too much for his body. Still suffering from his birth defect and his accelerated growth over the last of his teenage years, the back pain wasn't even the worst. Injuries to his groin led him to an eventual 4 surgeries, despite still being only 20 years old. That same season, he also marked his name in the Merseyside Derby's history for the first time, coming in with only 24 minutes to go and still managing to get a red card after a crazy challenge on Kevin Campbell. To be fair, it was the third red card of the match, you know. Just Merseyside things. In September, Gerrard's breakout season would start. He had just had his debut for the national team and had even gotten called up to the Euros, despite barely getting any game time. But still, it was a morale boost he needed, I guess. Over this season, he played an impressive 50 matches, establishing himself as a fan favorite, maybe because it was also the season he began developing his appetite for scoring goals, reaching double digits for the first time. He also won his first 3 trophies, a treble of cups, beating Arsenal to the FA Cup, Birmingham to the League Cup, and most especially winning the UEFA Cup, beating Roma, Porto and Barcelona on their way to the final. Gerrard got himself a couple of assists against Porto and even scored in the final, though to be fair there were 9 goals in that match. It was a really odd one. Liverpool somehow met Alaves from Spain in the final, who had been playing in the Spanish third tier just 5 years prior, but had been on an unbelievable run ever since, even signing players like Jordi Cruyff. Regardless, once in the final, Liverpool would be in front 2-0 in 16 minutes. By the beginning of the second half, it would be settled in a 3-goal draw, and in the last minute, Jordi would tie the match 4-4. A golden goal was all that was needed, and oddly enough, it came through a known goal by Alaves. It must have stung really hard for their fans, Jesus. To top off this incredible breakout season, Gerrard won the PFA Young Player of the Year. Over the next 2 years, he enjoyed some quiet times, with the main highlight coming as Liverpool unexpectedly beat Bayern Munich to the European Super Cup. But over the second of those years, something unexpected happened. By mid-November, Liverpool was top of the table, and having finished second in the previous season, there was some confidence. But what followed were 11 games without a win. By mid-December, they were 6th already. The season was a disaster. Houllier must have been looking for a way to shake things up, because seemingly out of nowhere, as the 2003-2004 season started, he stripped Sami Hupia of the captaincy and gave the armband to 23-year-old Gerrard. Controversial to say the very least, but it clearly didn't do any miracles. Houllier would be sacked at the end of the season. Over the summer, Gerrard would take part in the Euro 2004, finally getting some game time in the tournament after missing the World Cup over his groin injuries. But this exceptional golden generation of English football would be tumbled in the quarterfinals by Portugal's very own golden generation. Rafa Benitez took over this struggling squad, and somehow, despite him not having the best reputation for other clubs, it took Liverpool to one of their greatest ever seasons. Everyone knows the story, even I have told it what seems like a million times by now. Liverpool was down on their luck, they hadn't won anything domestically, but somehow they had made it to the Champions League final. But if they had beaten the odds against Chelsea and Juventus earlier in the tournament, the incredible AC Milan team that awaited them in the final wasn't up for no jokes. Gerrard has since admitted many times they were more than aware, they were the much weaker side. Maldini, perhaps the most experienced player in the pitch, having played 8 finals over his career and won 5, opened the score sheet only seconds into the game. By the halftime break, Milan led 3-0. By the 54th minute, Gerrard scored the most important goal of his career. A powerful header, like a true leader, he set off what is known as the Miracle of Istanbul. Just 6 minutes after that, the game was somehow tied at 3 goals each. Penalties come around to deck as one of the all-time great goalkeeping performances in my opinion, and Liverpool are against all odds, champions of Europe. I think some people don't realize how big this night was for the club. It wasn't just about the trophy. Gerrard had been debating whether it was time to move on and get himself his first transfer. It seemed like the most likely outcome, but as he said it himself, "How could I leave the club after a night like this?" Maybe Gerrard would have made a different decision had he known that this Champions League would be the last truly major trophy of his career. But to be honest, I doubt he regrets it. What made him great wasn't his trophy cabinet, because no trophy could have made up for the unbreakable bond he had with Liverpool. This season also brought him the UEFA Player of the Year award and a third place finish in the Ballon d'Or below only Frank Lampard and Ronaldinho. The next season was also one of his best, being his last somewhat successful season trophy-wise, winning both the European Super Cup, though he wasn't even called up for that match, and winning the FA Cup, for which he was absolutely essential. They met West Ham in the final, and it was almost like a much worse version of the Miracle of Istanbul. I guess you could say that in a way. Liverpool went behind 2-0 very early on, with Cissé pulling one back in the first half. But it wasn't Cissé who impressed during that goal. The standout moment was Gerrard's incredible 40-yard pass to assist him. Once the second half started, Gerrard scored with a mind-bending, powerful half-volley to level the match. But the suffering was yet to end, as West Ham yet again went in front. On injury time, Gerrard struck a magnificent, just one of the most incredible 40-yard half-volleys you could possibly imagine. Once again, they would go into penalties, and an incredible performance by their goalkeeper, this time Reina, would lead them towards the trophy. Despite not winning the league once the season was over, they just had to give it to him. Gerrard was the PFA Player of the Year. Over summer, he would play his first World Cup. He would score twice in a group stage, but the Golden Generation would once again be knocked out by Portugal on penalties early into the knockout stage. The following season, Gerrard would assume a much deeper role in the pitch, and his numbers would drop. Though he was still easily the main man in the squad, after a season with 36 goal involvements this time, he settled for a mere 17, though this season would also leave a mark on him for the rest of his career. Some call it AC Milan's revenge season. Liverpool went through a very similar path to the 2004-2005 season. Despite disappointing domestically, they beat Chelsea and Barcelona to the UCL final, where of course they met AC Milan. Inzaghi scored twice, and though Liverpool still pulled one back by the time they did, they were already going into injury time. It was too late, and this time around they would be the ones watching as AC Milan lifted the big trophy. 2007-2008 saw the induction of Fernando Torres into the squad, and his partnership with Gerrard would define a new era for the club. Described at times as telepathic, their relationship was incredibly prolific. The pair would be involved in nearly 200 goals over those 3 years, with 77 of those coming in just the first season. How they went trophyless, finishing only fourth in the league, still blows my mind. Injuries stopped them many times, only allowing them to be part of the same starting lineup 12 times over the season, so yeah, maybe that was it. To be fair, they did make it to the Champions League semi-final, though this time around Chelsea took the win. In their second season together, fittingly enough, they finished second. But still, they won no trophies, and there wasn't even that much hope of them taking the title at any point. By the third, it was just embarrassing. A 7th place finish, despite having so many incredibly talented players, they even finished below Aston Villa. As you might imagine, Rafa Benitez finally left. Roy Hodgson joined, but it didn't last very long. Kenny Dalglish took over, but it was too late to prevent Fernando Torres from leaving for Chelsea. This departure marked the starting of the end for Gerrard. He would go through 5 injuries over the next 2 seasons, missing nearly 30 games. Liverpool would finish 6th and 8th in the league, being severely affected when he was missing, though to be fair, 2012 would bring some memorable moments, with Gerrard finally winning another trophy after beating Cardiff City in a League Cup final, scoring a hat-trick in the Merseyside derby and getting to the final of the FA Cup. There was another meaningful moment in 2012 as Gerrard was made captain of the English national team, going on to have an impressive performance at the Euros, assisting a goal in every of the 3 group stage matches as England either won every game on minimal margin or drew, making him easily one of the most decisive players in the competition and being awarded a place in the team of the tournament. The rest of his time for Liverpool continued this seemingly endless cycle of disappointments, always finishing outside the top 5. Except for the second to last season, that was special. So, sit down kids, you're in for one hell of a story. Liverpool is finally top of the league with 3 matches to go. City is just 3 points behind. The next team they'll face is Chelsea. Liverpool hasn't lost for 16 games and has won the last 11. Luis Suarez is playing his last season for the club, being involved in 45 goals in 37 matches, an absolutely goal-scoring monster. Besides, there's also Philippe Coutinho, who's en route to become their next key player. The game goes all the way into the very last seconds of the first half without a goal. Then, Mamadou Sakho passes the ball to Gerrard, who's the last line of defense, and he's careless with the way he handles it, leaving it for Chelsea striker Dembaba to take. But it was still okay, Gerrard was there to defuse the situation, but then he slipped, falling to the ground as Dembaba took advantage of the situation and put Chelsea in front. Liverpool tried and tried, but they couldn't break Mourinho's defense. Brendan Rodgers even said it was like they parked 2 buses. In injury time again, Willian scored to make it 2-0. To further embarrass Gerrard, video footage of his pep talk against Man City a few weeks earlier would surface. Gerrard would poorly choose his words and end up foreshadowing his own demise, telling them that the title is ours. It will not slip now. You just can't make that up. City had games in hand, and if they won them all, the title would be theirs, given their superior goal difference, but Liverpool was so broken mentally that they didn't even force them into doing all that. Losing a 3-goal advantage to Crystal Palace in their next game, conceding twice in the last 10 minutes. If you're wondering how Gerrard felt about all of this, here's what he said in his autobiography. "I sat in the back of the car, and I felt the tears rolling down my face. I hadn't cried for years, but on the way home, I couldn't stop. I couldn't even tell if the streets were packed with traffic or if they were as empty as I felt on the inside. It was killing me." This was easily the closest Gerrard ever got to winning the Premier League. The absence of this trophy is perhaps the biggest stain in his otherwise impressive career. The reaction is very fitting, in my opinion. If this was already a sad way to go for Gerrard, the next season, he would play his last match at Anfield in an unfortunate 3-1 loss to Crystal Palace. It couldn't get much worse, but it did. His last ever game for the club was away against Stoke City. By the halftime break, they were losing 5-0. Eventually, the Stoke captain, Ryan Shawcross, would tell the press that the moment they got to the locker room at halftime, the coach didn't know what to say. As soon as the players started looking at each other, they all just burst out laughing. The game ended 6-1 with Gerrard scoring Liverpool's only goal, with many theorizing that the Stoke City players let him score on purpose. Just go look at the goal, something is really off there. I know some of you are gonna think I'm crazy, but I do kind of believe they did let him score. But honestly, I just think it's kinda cool if they really did. Regardless, this was Liverpool's worst defeat since 1963. Unbelievable. Leaving out the last few matches of his career, Gerrard joined LA Galaxy, playing for them only a year and a half, deciding to retire because the long trips around the USA were just too much and it was time to hang the boots. Gerrard retired as one of the most complete players in the history of the sport, capable of playing pretty much anywhere on the pitch. He was as much of a ball winner as he was a playmaker or a goal scorer even. It's a joy to watch him play, and the fact that he is considered by many the best player out of the trio of Gerrard, Lampard and Scholes, despite being the only one to never win the Premier League, just goes to show how incredible he was. Who do you think is the best out of those three? Comment below, I'd like to know. So, yeah, that was Steven Gerrard's career in a video. I hope you enjoyed, and yeah, see you next time. Bye.